are the salt of the earth. But what good is salt if it has lost its flavor? Can you imagine that? Shaking some salt on something and it doesn't get salty. That'd be weird. It says, can you make it salty again? It says this, it will be thrown out and trampled underfoot as worthless. Verse 14, you, say that's me. You guys are doing good, are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. Verse 15, no one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. Everybody say amen to that. So we're going to be talking a little bit about salt today, and I brought some salt. I brought some garlic salt. So you guys like that? How many of you guys have like a standby? You just shake whatever your favorite one on everything. It's like you know of no other seasoning. You just got that one, and it goes on everything. You got that? Yeah. Today is the day to expand your horizons. Wander down the spice aisle and just close your eyes and pick something different. You will make your family happy. We've got a Lowry's. How many people know what Lowry's is? How many know what Johnny's is, though? Yeah, see, Johnny's. It's like Johnny's and Lowry's. I can't tell the difference, but people, if they like Johnny's, they like Johnny's. Don't be giving me no Lowry's. Then we've got, the brother told me where it was. Pink Himalayan salt. Now, I must have closed my eyes when I bought it. I thought I was buying Hawaiian salt because everybody knows Hawaiian salt is the best salt in the world. I don't know why. So this is pink Himalayan salt. And then you got this one. I just got these out of my cupboard. This is sweet mesquite seasoning. Has anybody ever used this? You bought it at Costco, maybe? Costco plug. And then, there she is. Like, this is one of my childhood memories. I just remember her. In the rain. I think it's supposed to be salt, though. Anyway, okay, we'll keep going. Anyway, so we're going to talk about salt and how we are salt. If God says we are salt, then we are right, but you are not in here, okay? Everybody just get this out of your mind. You're not in here, okay? I'm going to read one more scripture, and then we'll pray, okay? It's from Luke 14, 34 and 35, again, from the New Living Translation. It says this. Now, listen to this, because it is a tad bit different, and I think it'd be good for us to look at this. It says, salt is good for seasoning. Everybody say amen. Amen. Yeah, has anybody ever cooked something in your house, and it was, like, not good? It wasn't good at all. And you were like, yeah, it's good. It's great. And you're over here just like shaking all the salt on there. Why? Because people know that salt makes things taste. They do. So salt is good for seasoning, but if it loses its flavor, how do you make it salty again? How do you make salt salty? It's saying, flavorless salt is good neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown away. Everybody say thrown away. Anyone with ears to hear should listen and understand. Everybody say amen. Amen. Say, Father God, help me to listen. Help me to understand what this word is saying today. Help me to be a light. Everywhere I go, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So we know that salt is good. You guys know that the earth is covered with what? Do you guys know what it is? It's like 70% of the earth is covered with what? Not just water, but salt water. Isn't that amazing how all the correlations there are with God about just everything? I mean, God is everywhere. He's speaking to people everywhere. And the witness that God is real is everywhere. You have to talk yourself out of saying there is no God. He is absolutely everywhere. Amen. I want to do this because I think I just like this. I want to read this out of the Message version if they bring it up here. I think this kind of will help us understand the message today. And I want to share this. It's been like 3 weeks since pastors ministered, but before guest ministers came in, I want to kind of give you some background on how I believe this kind of just this message stirred up in my heart is, he said, good things ought to be coming up out of us. You guys remember that? He was saying this, like, good things ought to be coming up out of us. And I don't know. It's easy. And Pastor Nate shared this at men's breakfast, and this is really good. He said, if we're not careful, we can go into what we call default mode. You're just going through the motions of life. And you can't have something good coming up out of you all the time if we're in this default mode and we're just going through the motions of life. And I know that when I heard that, it's like, good things ought to be coming out of you. And it's like, yeah, I agree with that, Pastor. I do. But then at the same time, we need to examine ourselves and go, are there good things coming out of me? And that doesn't mean, no, there's not good things coming out. I'm just worthless. No, that means get connected to God. Get plugged in so good things can come out of you, because there's only one place you can get good stuff, and that is, that's right. Amen. So here we go. You guys ready? So that's where I kind of got this. So you guys with me? I know it's been a while, but we're on this path of reaching people and getting people saved and good stuff coming out of us. And I believe that this is just what God had put on my heart. Are you guys ready? Matthew 5:13, Message version. We're going to read down through verse 16. It says this, let me tell you why you are here. You are here to be salt seasoning that brings out the God flavors of this earth. If you lose your saltiness, how will people taste godliness? You've lost your usefulness and will end up in the garbage. Everybody say, ouch. Here's another way to put it, just in case that you didn't like that part. Here's another way to put it. You are here to be light, bringing out the God colors in the world. God is not a secret to be kept. We're going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. If I make you light bearers, you don't think I'm going to hide you under a bucket, do you? I'm putting you on a light stand. And now that I've put you there on a hilltop, on a light stand, shine. Everybody say shine. I decided to label the message. Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. But I'm going to label this one if you're taking notes. And we agree here at the church that if you're going to go to heaven, you got to take notes. It's like a requirement to get in. And the title would be Shiny Salt, if you want to title the message. Shine. It says, keep open house. Be generous with your lives. By opening up to others, you'll prompt people to open up to God, this generous Father in heaven. Did you guys catch that? I bolded and underlined that. We're going to reference it again. I want us to hone in on why are we here? Because it's easy to get off track. Everybody can raise their hand to that. Don't do it, but it's easy, isn't it? You guys are just supposed to silently answer me in your head. We don't want to embarrass anybody. But no, it's easy to get off track. And God knows that. And God's full of grace, and he's always reaching out, and he's always bringing us back to this place right here. It's that middle ground. It's with him. Amen. Amen. Well, I just did a little quick study. You know, if we're going to talk about salt in the Old Testament, I'm going to bring her out. I'm going to let y'all look at her. In the Old Testament, salt symbolized cleansing and purity, right? But then you realize that if you were paying attention, when we read it here in the New Testament, he's talking about salt being used for seasoning and flavor. And so when I was looking at this, this word came to me. It's called balance. And how many know if we're going to live this God life, we have to be balanced? Amen? Have you ever, somebody made you something and it wasn't good, right? And you put some seasoning on it and it made it taste better, right? Or there's the time where they seasoned it and you were like, you barely got it to your tongue and you were like, oh, good Lord, what did you do to this? I mean, this was perfectly good meat until, what did you do to this? And what happened? They seasoned it too much. And so I want us to wrap our heads around this idea that we have got to be well-balanced people. Some of us is a little too much salt for some people. And I like to share this. We got this answer from the first service, but you would never put this on ice cream, would you? Well, you know what? Some people would. There's this weird, like, salt and straw, and they put, like, peppers in their ice cream. Oh. Normal people would not put this on ice cream, okay? All right. Are you calling me not normal? No, wait. Don't go there. So I do want us to get this idea that we are to walk this walk with God well balanced and not too much of this and not too much of that, but just kind of right down in the middle. Can everybody say amen to that? Amen. And before we get started, I just want to warn you, and I don't want you to get like this couple that I heard about. You see, the wife, she always got insulted because her husband was always in a very peppery mood. You didn't like that. Don't get in a peppery mood. Okay. I should have scratched that. I got the same response from the first service. Anyway, so how do we do this? How do we not be peppery to people and be salty to people? Well, I'm glad you asked. And I've got 5 points, and I would love for you to write them down, because if we're serious about winning people to the kingdom of God, then you'll write these down. You'll just do it. Number one, we gotta live wisely. I get this idea from Colossians 4, 5 and 6. It says, live wisely among those who are not believers and make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be gracious and attractive so that you'll have the right response for everyone. So number one, we said live wisely, and you can put a little sub note there that says you are to be gracious and attractive with the things and the words that you say. Everybody say amen to that. Gracious and attractive. Gracious and attractive. Your words, the things you say. Gracious. Not harsh and condemning and judgmental, but gracious and attractive. Amen. How are we to do this? Number two, we have to imitate God. Number two, imitate God. Now, listen, if you had siblings, raise your hand. You ever have like a sibling? Now, every sibling, I think, goes through his brother and his sister, but they'll go through this. What are you doing? What are you doing? Nothing, nothing. Stop it, stop it. And they like mimic you to the one will start, and they won't stop, and it will absolutely irritate the other person, right? It's called mocking them or whatever. But you know what? I've noticed if you act just like God, it don't bother him a bit. He actually likes that. He actually wants us to act like him. It doesn't bother him. So you can. You're not being prideful if you act like God. You're not being pompous if you actually act like God. And we'll talk a little bit about, well, how does God act? We'll talk about it in a little bit. So imitate God. That's number two. Ephesians 5, 1 and 2 says this. Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are his dear children. Live a life filled with love. Everybody say that. Live a life filled with love. Following the example of Christ, he loved us and offered himself for us as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma to God. I looked at that scripture and I was making this, and I looked at that. Living a life filled with love. And I kept looking at it. Living a life filled with love. And we all know God is love, and it was like, man. And I just got this, you know, honestly what I was thinking about was when Brother Alex preached a few weeks ago, and he was up here ministering, and it's happened many, many times. This is the one I'm referencing right now, where all of a sudden we're sitting here in church, and there's just God's pouring out his spirit. He's ministering to hearts, and then just I don't know how it happens, just God begins to deal with you, and he deals with you in love, and your heart starts to open up, and now all of a sudden you just feel lovey and ooey and gooey. And it's at that time you're not thinking about your bills. You're not thinking about, oh, what kind of new car am I going to get, or where am I going to go on vacation? You are just, you're almost mesmerized sitting in this place we call the presence of God, where he's pouring out his love. And you can't pour out the love of God unless he's first poured out his love on you. And I just want to say this. We're to live a life filled, not just a little bit, but filled with this love. You ever notice after those services, you're hugging on people. You're like, I love you. I love you too. If you had something against somebody, uh-oh. And I don't even know how that works. I really don't. How in the world do people come to church, worship God, and hate somebody, and have something against somebody? That's not living a life filled with love. The Bible says if you have something like that going on, get it right with that person before you go thinking you're going to worship God and receive the blessings of God. That's the word of God. You guys know that's in the Bible, right? So we've got to live this life filled with love. Number three, you do this by doing this, being compassionate and gentle / respectful. It's kind of three. Number three has three. I'm going to read, I got this idea from 1 Peter 3:15. I liked it out of the God's Word translation. And it says this, but dedicate your lives to Christ as Lord. Always be ready to defend your confidence in God when anyone asks you to explain it. However, everybody say however. However. Say however. However. Make your defense with gentleness and respect. Do you see the theme that's going on here? Gentleness, respect, a life filled with love, not this condemning, judgmental, I've got it all together and you need to come up to my level, brother. It's God's way. Amen. And here's what I've noticed. Golly, you don't need to look far before you bump into people who are hurting. People are hurting out there. I run a business, and I have one of our employees, and he's worked with us, and he hasn't not worked with me. He like has his own, he cleans a building. And so I never see him. I text him and I see him every occasionally. But lately he's been like working with us. And he just started saying things, you know, kind of throwing stuff out there. And I'm listening and I'm like, it just hit me. This guy's broken. This guy's hurting. And I don't know why. I don't know. This is just the way I feel like I'm attracted to these kind of people. Because I have a heart for people. And I'm like, well, and before I even know what I'm doing, I'm like, hey, you want to come work with us? You want to come work with us on this day? How about this day? You want to come work with us? So he's worked with us a few times. And every time, God is just confirming to me, man, this guy's hurting. And then it all kind of unfolded Friday. I'm working with this guy. And, I tell you this. You guys okay with this? Brought him to this house, and we're cleaning this house. Now, I got some other guys that are helping work with us, and they go to church here, and so we like listen to Christian music and stuff. You know, we don't listen to whatever, right? We live wisely, and we put good stuff in us, right? But something in me, and I don't know why, just before I knew what I was saying, I went over to him because we were getting ready to put on our jams, right? Where's my brother? Eric somewhere. And I just walked over to him, and I said, hey, you don't mind if we listen to Christian music, do you? I didn't care what he said. We were going to listen to it anyway, but I just thought I'd be polite enough to ask. I mean, he said, no, I don't mind. And I pretty much knew he would say that. And I just said, oh, cool. And I mean, we were already like finger was on play already, right? And then he began to share. And then he began to open up. And I said, are you a Christian? And I kind of, you know, knew he wasn't, because you can kind of tell by the way people live, right? And I said, are you a Christian? He goes, well, I was raised Pentecostal. I was like, whoa, brother, hallelujah. Because, you know, Pentecostals, they're like wild and crazy, and they swing from the rafters and all this other stuff. And so I was like, wow. He's like, yeah. He said something. He goes, yeah, spare the rod, spoil the child. You know what that means? Beat you to death. And he revealed something there, didn't he? sounded like he'd been abused. And that's what one thing I do not like is when it's in the name of God, you know, or, you know, it's because of the church and stuff like that. And so, there you are. We started talking to this guy, and you wouldn't need to say much to him. He just started just pouring out everything and talked about how he was depressed for years and years and years. And now he's in school to be a psychologist. I've heard Pastor preach this. I've heard him say, yeah, these people, they're so broken, and they're looking for all the right answers, and they're the ones that are going to help people, broken people, helping broken people. It's sad. And I asked him, because that kind of rose up in my heart, and I'm like, I said, so, brother, do you feel like you're healed from everything that's happened? He said, uh-uh. I was like, oh, dear Jesus. And he's going to school. And it just reinforces everything that we're getting ready to talk about today, and everything that I believe in is that God is the answer. He's the one that heals the brokenhearted. He's the one that rescues these kind of people and turns their sorrow into gladness and gives them true joy that a college education and some title, and you think you've dealt with it, but you really haven't, because until God helps you deal with it, you're just pushing it down somewhere. And guess what? One day it's going to rear its ugly head. And it's sad. And I'm telling you, these are the people we're bumping our shoulders with. These are the people that are working right next to us at our jobs. And God says, you're the salt. You're the salt of the earth. But being the salt, I just don't need you to be harsh and condemning. Yeah, there may be a time, but you need to speak some words of truth. But listen, we need to have access into these people's lives, and you do it by being gentle and compassionate and listen to them and find out about them and be interested in them. We've got this saying around here. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Isn't that so true? You're never going to be able to impart anything to anybody until they know that you care about them. Amen. Amen. And we certainly don't do this by judging them. And they know if we have that judgmental look. You know, there's a way about us, you know. We kind of put ourselves up here and we put them down here. And, man, that's not what I'm reading in the scriptures. Is that what you see? No. And so I'm so happy to be here that we can hone in on this and focus in on this a little bit and say, no, Lord, help me be the salt. Help me be the flavor so we can bring out the God flavors of this earth. Amen. Amen. You did number three. Let's do number four. Number four. I like this one, because I think I've fallen into this myself. Are you guys ready to jot this down? Number four, don't make it look hard. Make what look hard? Don't make our Christian walk and don't make our life look like it's a struggle. Like, man, I can't go with you. I can't go. I can't do it. Why? I gotta go to church. I gotta go to both services. Both of them. I gotta get up at like 7 o'clock in the morning. You get up at 7 o'clock in the morning to go to work every day and you're happy about it. Man, but you don't understand. We had men's breakfast yesterday. It was bad. I had to get up at 7:30. Whoever cooked, God bless them, they woke up earlier. They got up at 5:30, right? And I believe God just kind of ministered this to me. He said, don't make this look hard. Don't complain about having to do church stuff or praying or Bible reading. It said this life that we live should look easy. Why? Because we do it with the grace of God. Amen. Amen. So listen to this. Did you guys get that? I didn't tell you the scripture. Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Listen to this. This is number four. I like this. It said, then Jesus said, come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I'm humble and gentle at heart. And you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light. How many can sit here and say, you know what, maybe I have made it look a little too difficult? Well, that's okay. Just tap in to the grace of God. Tap into the love of God. And I'm telling you, God will make things easier, I promise. Amen. And I just love this story. And I don't believe it was me. How many of you know it's God working through us? It's not us. It's God working through us. God gets all the glory. It's not about us. And because without his grace, without his help, we can do nothing. That's what the Bible says. Apart from him, we can do absolutely nothing. Well, that's a little harsh. Well, maybe it is, but it's still true. Amen? It's still true. And so, I had this job. Now I don't have a real job. I just show up somewhere, I do stuff, and I get money. I don't really look at it as work. I don't. I'm kind of having fun, you know what I mean? And I get to work with fun people, and I get to just be around people, and, but I had a real job. Oh, I had a real job. You guys have real jobs? No. Listen, I'm going to say something. If you are complaining about your job all the time, maybe get with God. He may either have a couple different things for you. One, get your heart right. Two, he can tell you to get out of that job. Get yourself a new job. Three, he may go, you better keep your little hiney there. Get your heart right, because you ain't going nowhere till you get this thing right. Plus, I got people there you need to talk to. So, you guys must, I don't even, this didn't come out for a service, so you guys must be, you guys must want this, because, anyway. So anyway, I had this real job, and I was working with this guy, and I kind of worked, and I dealt with this side of things, and then he kind of dealt with this side of things, but we were working in the same area, and so we were always talking. We were always going back and forth, and it was kind of neat, because none of our stuff really kind of intersected. It just kind of worked, you know, and so when he would tell me stuff, or I would tell him stuff, we just had a good relationship. And then one day, another position opened up, and it was for sales. And part of the requirements was I had to talk to people. I'm like, yeah, you know I like to talk, and go to lunch with people. I'm like, seriously? And they want to pay you more money. Wait a minute. Yeah, that kind of opportunity is available. No, I think life should be hard. See, that's the problem. See, now I can't even get off that point. Some of you think life should be hard and you're doing something right. No, life should not be hard with God and his grace and his love. It should be easy. Should be easy, not hard. I feel like it's hard. Yeah, change that mindset and just thank God for his grace. Get with him, so maybe if he needs to change you, put you in a different place, you can do that. Or maybe it's amazing. If you just change your mind, the place where you're at will be a lot different too. Okay, we're done with that point. We're putting that one to rest. Anyway, so I take the new position, and I'm going out to lunch, and I'm talking to people, and I'm like loving life. I mean, things were great. I kind of felt bad come payday, because I'm like, I really haven't done anything. But I was reaching out to people. I was doing my thing. And then one day I go into the office and I bump into the guy that decided he wanted to take my job. And basically they gave him a bigger title. And so he did his job and my job. And he said one of the reasons why he took that job, because the upper manager came to him and said, well, do you want that job? And he was like, yeah, because he looked at me and he was like, you don't really do anything all day, so why don't I just do it? And they'll pay me more money. He ends up telling me this. And I end up walking into the office after he'd been doing the job for a little while. And he was kind of rubbing his eye, and he was sitting back in his chair, and he looked at me and he just started shaking his head. I said, what's up, brother? He goes, I had no idea all the stuff you did. I said, what do you mean? He's like, when did you do this? When did you do that? How were you getting this and this and that done when you had all this other stuff to do? I said, I don't know. I'll go to lunch now. I don't remember that. I hope they're paying you well. He said the reason why he said he could do that job was because it didn't look like I did anything. And I believe I got a revelation. It's like, wow, God, you were making that look easy. You made it easy for me. It made it look easy so he would want that job. But you know what? Man, I did a lot of stuff. But by the grace of God, I got it done. Come on, there's some people in this room, man, I tell you what, my hat goes off to you. I see you got young kids. You're traveling from dear Lord, three different zip codes to get here, and you're doing a lot of stuff. And I know God sees that. But don't do it without his grace. Let him help you. Let him sustain you. Let it be easy, because that's when life is fun. Amen. Let it be easy. And sometimes it's just a little change in our thinking. Just a little change in our thinking can turn our life around. Amen? Amen. So he was stuck with the job, and then later I left that place, and he didn't last very much longer. But we're still good friends today, and I've definitely preached Jesus to him. I do want to say this, that this is important. You know, I told you about that guy that I work with, and this was another time in my life. I just love this point. Just kind of follow me, because you guys may have similar things going on in your life. When I left that job, I went and started a business, and then I was doing this business. I was working a lot of hours, and I started coming to this church during that transition, and I got introduced to what prayer really is, you know, getting filled with the Holy Ghost and praying in tongues. Mm-hmm. That's really praying. And when you can pray in the Holy Ghost and you can pray out mysteries and know what God wants for you, I was finding all this out, and I was listening to these Brother Hagin tapes. And check this out. I wanted to share this because it's pretty fun. On a Walkman. I had a Walkman. And I'm starting to think, I ain't even that old, but what was I doing with a Walkman? But it was on a Walkman, and I'd listen to these tapes all night, and then I'd get home, and I don't know, do you guys have to unwind a little bit when you get home? I mean, even if it's late at night, you got to just kind of like, praise the hallelujahs, what just happened today? Whew. And I'd sit there at 1 o'clock and 2 o'clock in the morning, and I just start thinking about these tapes I was listening to, and God was just starting to deal with me. And I realized that the closer I got to him, the more my heart opened up to people. And I would pray, and I would, you know, read more scriptures. And next thing you know, it's like 2 or 3 in the morning. I did this for a while. I don't even know when I was sleeping. I'm like, Lord, when did we sleep? Because like 3 in the morning, back up at 6:30, 7 o'clock in the morning, you know, after working a really, really long time. And then because I was getting closer to God, God's put in my heart, says, you need to go preach Jesus. Go share Jesus. I'm like, okay. And so, you know, I got with Pastor, and I had this idea to go out to the max and start ministering Jesus to people. It was for a long time, for like 2.5 years, every Saturday, we went out and we shared Jesus with people. And I look back at that time, and I'm like, dear Lord, throw in small children, being married, you know, trying to figure life out, finances, all that other stuff. And I look back at that time, and I believe this is an answer for some people too. You see, your issue is not your bills and getting this new thing or that old thing. The issue is, how do we be salt? How do we be light? Because it's in doing that, in being those things, that all these other things get taken care of, and we really experience the grace of God. And I look back at that time, and I'm like, how in the world did we get all that done? I look back at it now, and it looks scary. Like, I wouldn't even want to, like, I said two things. I wouldn't even want to pick a couple of those things and pick those things up right now. Unless God said so. I mean, it was like, dear God, how did we do that? And God is always, and just in his love, he said, that's my grace. Just like he told Paul that one time, he said, it's my grace is sufficient. And if it was good enough for Paul, if his grace and his love was good enough for Paul, it's definitely good enough for us. So you may go, how do I get this? Just ask. Ask by faith, believe, and receive. Say, Father God, from this day forward, I'll walk in your grace, filled with your love, being salt and a light for all to see. That's how you do it. And you just say that, and you say that, and then you begin to believe it, and then you begin to experience it, and then you'll look back on your life and go, wow. And guess what? All the while, here's the reason. People are watching you. People are watching us. And I'm going to tell you this. People are going to watch you closer, not when you get the Lamborghini and the new house and you just get back from vacation. They're going to watch you closest when things are going on in your life, when you're maybe pressed a little bit and challenged, right? Not when things are going good. It's not the time to cave in when things go bad. The word doesn't change. You're the salt of the earth. You're the light of the world. I'm putting you on a lampstand. But I got stuff. Yeah, keep being salt. Just don't worry about stuff. Be salt. Be light. Amen. 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 You guys are doing good. You guys are doing good. Oh, I did make this note. I think it's good. Don't be fooled by the facade people put on like they don't need Jesus. Because I got to tell you, before I ever stepped out into do that Max ministry, God really put this on my heart big time. And I've never forgot it. And I'm telling you, it sustained me because life happens. Life will happen. Challenges will come. And I'm telling you what, the last thing you want to hang your hat is you don't believe in Jesus no more. You don't believe in this God stuff anymore. I mean, I'm telling you, don't ever, ever do that. And God said to me, he says, everybody needs Jesus. And it's like, yeah, that ain't very deep. No, listen, we can be fooled by what people put on. We can be fooled by the places they go, the things they're doing, the degree that they got, and the words that they use, and they think they got it all made. And I'm here to tell you, if they don't have Jesus, they have nothing. They don't have anything. They don't have life. John 3 says, without being born again of the Spirit, you can't even see the kingdom of God. None of this stuff even makes sense. And so they need us to be salt and flavorful so at the right time we can minister the gospel to them. It may not happen every day, but every day you can be salt. And at the right time, there'll be an opportunity because the Bible says so. We already read it. Without God, we can do nothing. And so don't be fooled. Well, pastor says, I got to get somebody saved. Jesus, who am I going to get saved? Oh, I just can't think of anybody. Wrong approach. Wrongo bongo approach. Number one, be salt. Let the love of God fill you to overflowing, that it comes out of you and I, right? Then you'll just notice yourself in the right place at the right time. Because you haven't, and I haven't been condemning and judgmental, and we've been gracious and kind and compassionate and understanding with people. Wow, it's funny how this door just opened for me to minister the gospel. But if you're in default mode, if you're in autopilot, and you just worried about your thing, and I'm worried about my thing, then we, Billy Graham, you know what he said? They asked him just recently, what would you have changed? You know, and Billy Graham, he said he would have read his Bible more and prayed more so he could reach more people. And that's when those some people, and don't do this, they read that, I've lost my saltiness. I've lost it. You're right, Brian, you're right. I lost my saltiness. And it's just, I'm good for nothing to be thrown in the garbage. No. We're not saying that. Who said that? Nobody said that. Don't give up. Amen? Amen. Now, I want to do this. Listen to this. Everybody needs God. Do you guys agree with that? Don't let people trick you because they do. I mean, let me just tell you, I talk to a lot of people, and what the words they're saying, because they were so intelligent in their mind, and the things they philosophized and just leaned to their own understanding and figured out because they went to school and did this and that and the other, and like, it's like they can seem smart. They can seem like they've got it all together, and I'm telling you, ask them the question, are you saved? Do you know God? If they say no, then you've got somebody. They need Jesus. Get through the song and the dance so we can get to the party. I made that up. We'll see about that later. Listen to that. See if that makes sense later. I don't know. Listen to this. Listen to this. 1 Corinthians 6. 1 Corinthians 6. Let this just listen to this. Don't you realize that those who do wrong will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't fool yourselves. Then we just say that. Those who indulge in sexual sin or worship idols, commit adultery, or male prostitutes, practice homosexuality, or thieves, or greedy people, or drunkards, or who are abusive, cheat people, none of these will inherit the kingdom of God. None of them. It says some of you were once like that. No, I wasn't. Yes, you were. No, I wasn't. Yes, you was. But some of you were made once like that, but you were cleansed. You were cleansed. You were made holy. You were made right with God by calling on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of our God. We've been cleansed. We've been made right. But we haven't always been like that. And this is another key thing. If you are taking notes, or you're just going to listen to this over and over and over because you really are serious about winning souls, is remember Old Testament for cleansing and for purity, right? New Testament, they refer to salt as flavor, right, and seasoning. And so we talked about this balance, right? And I was getting this message, you know, trying to get it all put together, and you know, and then you hear from God. And this is what I sensed in my spirit, and I really want to make this point, because it's not just about being nice and gentle and compassionate and respectful. Yes, it is, but it's not the whole mammo jammo. Did you write that down? It's about all of that, but it's about proclaiming truth. And then you've got these people, they want to be way over here. Look at Jesus when he turned over the tables and when Peter cut that dude's ear off. That's what I'm like. I'll be chopping ears off. No, no. Jesus had to put that ear back on. Don't you know nothing? Listen, we've got to be balanced. And we've got to be gentle and respectful and compassionate and pray for a door of opportunity to open up, so when we're in these people's lives, because we've won their hearts, because they've seen God's love through us, or they've seen our love that really is God's love, now they have a listening ear. And instead of chopping it off now, they can listen with it. And they'll listen to what you have to say. So if you are making another side point, it's not just about being nice, it's about proclaiming truth. And that needs to be something that you just carry around with you. You know, you can't just be, you know, Bible whipping everybody all the time. There may be a time you need to speak some truth to people. And just like swimming in the ocean when you've got a little cut, as soon as you get in, you're like, oh, I didn't know I had that cut, dear Lord, because it stings a little bit. But guess what? After a while, don't you know that cut is going to heal much, much faster because of the salt water than it would have normally? And that's what we're to be to people. We're to be cleansing, showing them the way, and then giving them the answer. It's truth that sets people free, not nice. I'm just going to say something right here. There are a lot of nice people in hell. Well, I don't like that. Then let it be salty to you, but it's still the truth. And there's got to be a boldness on the inside of us where we're able to share that truth with people and be okay if they reject it. Guess what? They may. They may. But that doesn't mean we just don't share it, right? Amen. So, number five. You guys ready? I love this one. This is a good one. Never forget where you came from. Never forget where you came from. Amen. Man, it don't take me but about 3 seconds to think about what God has done for me, how he's helped me, and how he continues to. That how dare me ever get judgmental? How dare me ever look down on somebody and think that I'm better than them and they need to rise up to my level? Because you think about that for a couple seconds. Well, aren't we supposed to put everything in the past and never remember that stuff ever again? 1 Corinthians 15:8. Let's read this. 1 Corinthians 15:8. Then last of all, let me tell you this. You know that Jesus was seen by over 500 people after he was resurrected from the dead? Do you know that he presented himself to people? This is real stuff. People that don't believe, we need to keep sharing the truth with them. This is real stuff. Now listen, this is Paul's talking. Verse 8, he said, and he's saying, then last of all, he was seen by me also as one born out of due time. Verse 9, for I am least of the apostles, whom not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God that was in me. This is Paul who saw Jesus, who had a complete transformation. He preached the word. He were reading this book that he has written to us that was inspired by God. I don't know. You see people, they meet a celebrity and they're like, I met that guy. Like, he saw Jesus. And now he's saying, I'm not even worthy to be called an apostle. This is what I used to do. And guess what? You can also remember what you used to do, so it'll help you appreciate the salvation that you have. I don't ever want to forget where I've come from, because it keeps me in this place called humbleness. I don't ever want to get up here. How about you? I don't ever want to forget where I came from and I'm all high and mighty, because it's people will sense that. People need to sense this life filled with love pouring out of us, that we're listening to them, we care about them, and we'll go the extra mile for them, right? That's the kind of people God has called us to be. And I'm telling you what, God's grace will be there to help you. Amen? Amen. Well, that's number five. So let's stand on our feet. We're just going to end with some prayer and a confession. I trust that God has said something to somebody. How many just by a show of hands, you're just reminded why you're here. You're reminded that you need to be salt. That's what God has placed us here in this earth to do and to be, is to be salt, to be a light, to be a blessing, right? And so let's not forget that. How many here tomorrow, you know somebody you can bump into tomorrow at your job, somewhere, your neighbor, and you can be salt to them. You can, instead of whatever you've been doing, you can just let love flow out of you. How many can do that? How many can do that this week? Amen. Well, Father, we praise you and we thank you for this wonderful word. We thank you that you've got us focused, Father, on what is really important, and that is that you've called us to be salt. You've called us to be a light into this world. And so, Father, I just thank you that there is a grace upon each and every one of us to be salt and light, to know the right thing to say, to know the right people to talk to, Father. Lord, give us eyes that will see the people around us that are hurting. Lord, help us to be a blessing to them. And Lord, we just thank you that there will be doors of opportunity to minister to people the love that you've poured out onto us into them. And so, Father, we just thank you for it. Father, we thank you. We speak that by faith, that there'll be opportunities for us this week to minister and to love on people and to show them your goodness and your kindness that you have for them. Father, you're so good. Lord, may we never forget, ever, ever forget where you've brought us from. Thank you, Father. Bless you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Think about somebody right now. We're just going to pray for people right now. Just think about somebody in your life. Listen, they're They're lost without Jesus. They are absolutely not going to the right place. So think about somebody right now. You can pray and just agree. We're going to lift up souls in our lives and people in our lives because you don't want them to go to hell. I promise you that. You don't want them to go there. And so let's just pray for them right now. Father, we lift up the souls and the people in our lives. And Lord, we just thank you. Lord, that we thank you that their eyes will be open to the gospel and to hearing the message of Christ and that there is hope for them. Father, I thank you that as we go out into our worlds, Lord, that you would help us. Lord, we lift those people up in our lives right now. Father, we thank you for their salvation. Satan, we just say you have no authority in their lives. We call them saved by faith, and we thank you that they'll serve you with gladness all the days of their life. Father, we thank you for more people to go into their path, to minister the word. And Father, we thank you that seed will be watered until it comes to full fruition, Father. And Lord, we expect phone calls. We expect chairs to be filled, Father. And Lord, we thank you that souls are being saved because we're the light. We're the light. We're the light. Say, I'm the light. Say, I'm the salt. Say, Father God, use me everywhere I go. In Jesus' name.